Hey guys, welcome to another episode of Heart to Heart with Shayma and Romaine. And
hello,
I'm your grateful host, Romaine.
And this is Shayma.
All right, so in today's episode, we're going to talk about showing support to each other.
Yes.
Through pregnancy.
How do we get through this?
Yeah. well, basically, she literally takes on the most labor in this process. So I think my job is just to provide any additional support or basically to do anything that is required, because I'm not the one actually carrying the baby. So that includes, you know, physical support, emotional support, just being there, I think is good. For you?
Yes, me. Yeah, it's good. Don't leave.
Yeah, it's just you, and not just, I don't mean just being there physically, like we're here now. I mean, like, mm-hmm. also mentally, like communicating with each other. How can I do this better? Can I help you with this? And, you know, that's what I think in terms of showing you support.
I think I had
Also, sorry to interrupt, but also educating yourself on the process. I mean, I'm not going to be breastfeeding, but we recently purchased this course from Tiny Hood, and I've been watching it over and over about the breastfeeding process, even though I'm not going to breastfeed. But I think it's great to educate yourself on the process. So if for any reason you could offer some advice, or if my wife is, you know, communicating with me on, oh, she's not latching on this way, I can say, well, I learned that we can try it this way. So I think as the father, there are instances where you don't think that you can actually provide input, like going back to breastfeeding, but I think you can actually provide very valuable input. Even though if you're not going to be physically performing said task, I think you can acquire the knowledge so you can help to make the process more effective for both parties.
I think about these things, what is more important than being able to give advice or anything, because you may not be able to give me advice because you still will not have the experience, mm-hmm. or will not be living my circumstances.
Gotcha.
But you will at least understand what is a really hard job.
Yes,
and
yes.
And what is not, you know?
Absolutely.
Because, like, for example, with breastfeeding, for a lot of people, it is an easy thing. You take the baby, you put the baby on your boob, and baby sucks.
And then I learned that it's not that easy.
Yeah. With exactly. the courses you took, you exactly. understood that it is not that easy. So when I'm having problems in the future, you will know why, and you'll be more understanding,
yes.
and you'll be more supportive.
Going back to, like, what I said about educating yourself.
You may not be able to tell me, like, how to latch the baby, because I'm taking the same courses with you, but you will at least understand my pain during the process, because a partner that is not understanding is the worst thing.
Mm-hmm.
When we are going through something, and then he's like, yeah, you're just breastfeeding, aren't you made for that?
Well, that's a douchebag, so it's slightly different. And also a partner who is unwilling to learn and educate himself.
Yes. I believe dads are supposed to take all the courses that we are taking
100%,
at this process, because I hear a lot, like, I am in a lot of moms groups, I hear a lot that, like, people's, like, partners, they don't know what to do with anything. They don't take the same courses. They don't give the same amount of effort in learning. And then when baby comes, when they are trying to do something to help, and I say help even though they are parents.
Yeah, exactly.
They are not supposed to help. They are just supposed to do their job.
Yeah, as a parent.
Even when they try to help, it's not going to be good. He's just going to be picking up the baby without holding her head and stuff.
Yeah.
And then when mom tries to correct these things endlessly, like again and again, no, you can't do this. No, you should do this this way.
Yeah.
And then the guy gets mad saying,
gives up.
It's my child. Why are you not letting me? And then gives up saying, yeah, I can't do it.
Yeah.
Yeah, that is something that happens a lot. So that's why I think that it is very important for the dad to take the responsibility of learning.
Oh, 100%.
Without being taught by the mother.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. You have to, as the father, you have to take the initiative to learn, not just, hey, babe, how do you do this? Hey, babe, how do you do that? And babe, what do you do with this? I mean,
some things, yeah, but not everything.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, not everything. So, and things should be like decided together.
Mm-hmm.
For some subjects, I hear like moms decide solely on something and dads just follow. Or dads decide on it and then moms just follow. Like we were talking about circumcision issues before.
Yeah.
I see a lot of moms saying that, well, I don't have the same equipment, so I'm not qualified to make this decision. Whatever my husband or partner wants, that is what we are going to do to the child. Yeah, I don't think so.
Yeah, I don't think so either.
Because if he is circumcised or not, he will just only know one of the experiences.
Exactly.
He will not know both of the experiences. Yeah. So like, it's still having the same equipment or not is not gonna matter, and it's your child too. You have to decide together.
I agree 100%.
But like, for example, with breastfeeding, deciding on like a formula feeding or breastfeeding, we will talk about it and then like decide together in the end. But I would expect that, like, if I am telling you that, like, hey, this is too much for me, I can't.
Exactly.
And then since you know how hard it is and what I'm going through, then you'll be like, yes.
Not only that, but I can't then say, well, you still have to breastfeed.
You have to do it.
Exactly. It hurts your nip. It doesn't matter if you feel pain and, you know, she's biting her nipples, you still have to do it. It's like, no.
Yeah, at some point it's,
Yeah, at some point you have to be understanding. Not at some point, you should always be understanding.
But still, I wouldn't say that, hey, it is none of your business. I think that's too harsh to not involve them into the decision making at
all.
That's true. As long as the guy is not like abusive or something.
Yeah.
Yeah. So like.
So in terms of supporting you, what would you say? All right. Morning sickness and fatigue.
Morning sickness time was hard.
Yeah.
Right. That was a hard time. And you got me a lot of pickles.
So. Yeah, she had a pickle fetish.
First trimester. I ate a lot of pickles. You got me a bunch of pickles.
Literally, like every day, I would get like 2 to 3 cans of pickles.
Oh my god. So much pickles.
Yeah, pickles.
I ate some. And I wouldn't eat anything else. I lost so much weight in the first time because I was just eating pickles and nothing else. Yeah, he would go and get the things that I
That's crave. Part of being supportive, you know?
But, you know, in my culture, that's like going and buying whatever your wife craves during pregnancy is a big thing.
Yeah.
Like that you need to do.
In this culture as
but
well.
But also in my culture, also men are not that supportive during pregnancy. So that is literally the only thing they do.
I think that's a man thing.
Yeah.
Some men.
Yeah,
some
that men. Is literally the only thing they care about doing. Hey, she was craving and I got her the food. But then in the morning, she's going to clean the house and cook for me.
Jeez.
You know?
No. Yeah. I mean, pregnancy or not, that's not a woman's role.
Yeah.
Like the cleaning.
Yeah, one thing for support was the household chores. We were always like sharing everything.
Yeah, exactly.
And then we were always like, we didn't decide on ever like who is going to do what.
Yeah, that's
but
true.
We were just doing like whatever we can at the moment. I see dishes, I do the dishes.
I see dishes.
You see dishes and then you do the dishes.
I do the laundry, I change a cat litter.
But when I got pregnant, some things changed because some things he had to take over. Like, for example, right now our washing machine and dryer is downstairs in the basement.
Yeah.
And carrying that from up and down is not...
Exactly. Yeah.
Something I can do or like I wanna do it. Maybe I can, but like I would have to take them.
No,
like,
and I wouldn't want her to do it.
Yeah.
I mean, eventually if she says I wanna do it, I can't force her not to. But I would rather her not to do it.
So like and he does not, that and then I fold them.
Yeah, exactly.
Bed, so
yes.
it's easy
yes.
for me.
Yes.
And cat litter. Actually, I did a lot of research on cat litter changing with, you know, toxoplasma, the disease that you might catch during pregnancy. It's not that dangerous. And it is very low possibility if the cats are house cats and they are not feeding on raw meat. They are not feeding on prey. It's a very low possibility, but first time we went to the doctor, we asked, and the doctor said, no, don't change it yourself, and he would never let me do it again.
Exactly. It's like, why take the risk? It takes literally a couple seconds to clean a cat litter.
Yeah.
So that's, I wouldn't even really call that a real task. It's just cleaning the cat litter.
Yeah. I think with household chores, like, the biggest thing was that we didn't care so much.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
Yeah, we never.
I mean, we are not that kind of people, anyways. My house never looks perfect, and like you not caring as well, like it helped me a lot because I'm not under pressure to like
constantly
cleaning or anything. Yeah. We just survive. I mean, like first trimester was really hard because of all the nausea, and I was so fatigued. Second trimester was not bad, but we were moving.
Yes,
so
exactly.
So we did a lot of moving work to do, and I worked a lot during second trimester. We were actually very lucky with that timing.
Yeah.
Because that was like, if you remember, that was literally the only time that I was actually able to work. Because
true.
First trimester I couldn't because
morning
of nausea.
And all that stuff.
And right now I literally can't carry anything now, so like I can't do any work
so
now.
That's, yeah,
so that
timing.
Was a perfect timing for
definitely
us because I did a lot of furniture installation and stuff in baby's room. Oh, we should do a nursery tour at some point, by the way.
I think we did one, but we can do a new one.
Yeah.
Because now
we should with the podcast.
Yeah, because now the nursery is pretty much
and yeah, completed. Nursery is ready now.
Ready,
so.
Yeah.
Yeah, at that time I worked, but right now, for example, now that I'm approaching 40 weeks, I'm nesting. So in the last 2 days, I have started to do a lot of cleaning and stuff.
Yesterday, I came home and she was vacuuming at 10 p.m. So yeah, that happened.
And then at 3 a.m., I was still working.
Oh, yes. Yes, I think I was sleeping.
Yeah, you were sleeping and I was in the closet trying to fold clothes and stuff.
Yeah.
Yeah, but right now I'm able to do a little bit in the last few days, but I was not able to do much in the third trimester at all.
Mm-hmm.
I was barely like cooking and then dishes every once a day or so, or every 2 days.
Yeah, I was gonna say.
Whenever the machine is full and it needs to be changed. Yeah, that's it. And everything else he was doing.
Which, again, it's not a lot. It's literally...
Yeah, it's not a lot.
All right, so...
We don't have such a big house. Two of the rooms, we don't even go in anyways.
Yeah.
We have a bedroom and this living room.
Yeah.
And,
yeah, it's not a...
When you're not getting into the room, cleaning is not a problem.
That's true. Yeah. All right, so we do the laundry once a week. Cat litter. We take out the garbage once a week. So... I wouldn't say so in terms of chores for supporting each other, I wouldn't even consider that a part of it.
Yeah.
And in terms of other support, it's just making sure you're very comfortable. Because my wife can barely walk up the steps sometimes because, you know, labor pains and we're approaching 40 weeks. So, I mean, outside of that, it's very easy. Like, to show support. It's incredibly easy, actually. But then we would read on, like, Reddit or other forums where some of these women are going through a lot.
Yes,
a lot.
Like, I was just reading someone's husband is mad. By the way, she's also, like, 40 weeks or so. Mad because she is not folding the laundry at the same day. And they are they are doing laundry every day.
Yeah.
And I was like... We are doing the laundry
once a week.
He is the one doing it, and I still don't fold it every day. same day. It's like,
guess what?
Why?
We're fine. We're perfectly fine.
Our clothes are still clean.
Exactly. Yeah.
We don't have to wear anything dirty. I really don't get it. And like, how can a man complain that a 9-month pregnant woman is not folding
the laundry the same day?
What does that even like?
Yeah.
How can that happen? I don't know. It's so weird. Like, is that your priority right now? She can go into labor any minute, and you are thinking about laundry not being done.
I think it's about priorities too, and misguided priorities in that instance. So yeah, I mean, for me, it's been incredibly easy.
Yeah. For me too. Yeah. I mean, I am one of the very few women at this point still not saying that, get this baby out of me.
Yeah.
Like.
Yeah. So would you say this has been an easy pregnancy?
It has been like an easy pregnancy, and I think I owe it to your support. Because, I mean, you don't expect something that I am going to have to really struggle to provide right now.
Yes.
Yeah. And yeah. So like, it makes it so much easier for me because I can't cook some days, and then you're just like, hey, let's order this, like, yeah. and then I relax, and I know that cooking is not like my job or anything, but then you could have expected it because like, you are doing everything else basically. I'm just cooking.
No, I would say it's a teamwork kind of thing. I think that's one of the reasons why it's for us it's easier than some of the couples we were reading about, because before we even got pregnant we were working as a team, and we would never had these crazy expectations like, oh, make sure the laundry is folded the same day, or make sure dinner is cooked when I get home. We never had those bizarre, outdated expectations. So I think that's one of the reasons why this is easy for us.
Yeah.
I'm trying to think of what has actually changed since you got pregnant. Yeah. Like, did we switch up some routines, or I mean, besides the cat litter?
Yeah, I mean, laundry, you are doing it like
long now. Okay.
I was doing it more before.
Gotcha. And the cat litter, I guess.
And you are doing bathrooms alone now.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. Because he doesn't want me near the chemicals so
much. The bleach and all that stuff.
Yeah. At the first trimester, I was still doing it, I think. But then you took over, but mostly.
Yeah. Trying to think.
I can still vacuum and stuff.
Yeah. Well, yeah. So, see,
we don't have so much to do. That's fine.
Yeah.
We don't have a child yet. Like, it's harder for people who actually has other children, because children still needs to be taken care of. They don't care if you have fatigue or not, morning sickness
exactly.
or whatever.
If
we had that, then it would have been a bigger problem for us, I think.
Bigger problem? So it's a problem now?
No, it's not a problem. It would be a problem.
Yeah, it's no problem at all. It's actually very chill.
With aching, the cramps, and like the pains that I'm going through, I think you were very supportive with that too, because you gave me massage and stuff. So. One issue I had, and I think that should be mentioned during a support segment, is the body issues and self-confidence issues during pregnancy. A lot of women, like most women, has problems during pregnancy, being scared or like hating how they look.
Appearance.
So many things change on your body, you know, and some of the changes like are not gonna go back after pregnancy. They are gonna stay with you forever.
But I mean, I love my wife, you know, and you're beautiful and you're literally carrying our child. So yeah,
in the beginning I was very scared because for example, like the stretch marks, you were seeing some on Instagram, another woman, and we were like, ew. And I was like, it's gonna happen to me too. What is he gonna think then?
By the way, that was a joke. Yeah. That was me joking around. All right, so stretch.
Yeah, front. I was very scared in the beginning that, yeah, that's gonna happen to me too. And then like, what will you think?
Oh, yeah.
And I knew that you would just say, no, you look good. But then I wasn't going to believe you because you already made your opinions very well known.
I was definitely being jovial when I made those comments.
He was like, yeah, that's never going to happen to you. Yeah. Right? And I'm like, it will.
I mean, obviously, we... Either way, it's still beautiful, you know? You're bringing a life into the world. Stretch marks are literally a non-factor.
Yeah, I got over it after a while anyways. Yeah, I don't think they...
So besides the stretch marks, any other body issues?
No, I don't think I changed so much. Actually, I think pregnancy looked really good on me.
Yeah.
Yeah, because like...
I agree.
Thank you. Because like I didn't have any problems with other parts of my body anyways. I was just like used to be like self-conscious about how my belly looked because I didn't look so snatched and stuff. Right now I have an excuse for it. So like I feel really good.
Yeah.
One problem I had with my body is gone now. So
so
I feel really good and I feel beautiful. I don't feel bad at all now. I think I'm gonna miss this after pregnancy. I'm gonna have to look good after.
It's gonna be super easy.
Yeah. I mean, I also did not gain so much weight. Mm-hmm. That of course factors into.
You were actually losing weight.
Yeah, in the beginning I was losing.
Yeah.
Then I gained that back at the second trimester.
Yeah.
I didn't gain so much, and most of my gain has been like just my belly and baby.
Baby. Mm-hmm.
And like other parts, my clothing size did not change.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of the clothes that I had before, if they had a like loose type of belly, mm-hmm. I am still able to wear them.
Gotcha.
So I don't feel so bad.
It's good, babe.
Yeah, I mean, pretty like good. The dress that I wear like very often, the flowery dress, like
yeah,
that's not
yeah.
a pregnancy dress.
Love that dress.
That's a dress that I used to wear before.
Oh,
yeah.
Speaking of which, I remember before, like, in the initial stages or right before the initial stages of us getting pregnant, I was gonna buy clothing for her. You said no, wait,
yeah,
because of the, for some reason she thought she was gonna end up like Kirby or like a balloon or something.
I told him, we don't even know what will I look like in
exactly.
a few months. Maybe I'll be like 2-3 sizes bigger than this. We can't buy maternity clothes yet. We don't know how well thinking that. I still bought some clothes that was just like one size bigger than me, but maternity clothes.
Yeah.
As a result, they still don't fit me. They are still big.
Exactly. But to be fair,
I can make them work, but they are big.
And also, we didn't know what was going to happen.
Yes, we didn't at all.
Yeah. And now we do.
And my size didn't change. And for a lot of people like who are having like issues with like not being able to find clothing, I think they are not actually buying the maternity clothes.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of women are not buying maternity clothes, and then like they are just trying to buy a few sizes bigger to be able to like just get by.
Huh. So
and then they are having a lot of self-confidence issues because think about it, you are like, you used to be like size S and then you have to buy X large now and it barely fits you. Of course you are gonna feel terrible.
Yeah,
with just by the names of those sizes. You used to be as small, now you are X large. Of course you are gonna feel bad, but the same person, maybe she is gonna be able to get into size small maternity clothing. And like, not all maternity clothing is the same either. Like, remember I showed you some photos of maternity clothing only for the first trimester because there is no way that's gonna fit a like 7, 8, 9 months belly.
Yeah.
Some maternity clothing that is sold online is a joke. They are not for pregnant women. It's so weird.
That's funny.
But yeah, normal maternity clothing that you are gonna find mostly on like Amazon or ASOS or Motherhood Maternity, the places that we buy mostly, right?
Mm-hmm.
We also like Shein. We had a few things from Shein. Is a hit and miss.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah,
it's not a hit and miss.
Maternity
place. I got some maternity things from there.
Yeah,
some of them was nice. Some of them I never wore because they were not
good. Like the sizing was bigger, or was it
this? Sizing was bigger. Sizing was really big. Those are the ones that I still can't get into.
So how does that work? How would you have a small in regular and a small in maternity? What changes in the maternity version?
The only thing that is supposed to change is to let some place on the belly.
Gotcha.
Like this dress, for example, is a normal dress. It's just branch up here and has a bigger belly.
Gotcha.
So it fits your belly. So it's not supposed to have any other thing. If it is also nursing friendly, of course you are gonna have some opening here too. Mm-hmm. No, I have like one. Like
yeah,
that.
Exactly. Yep. Only one?
As an outside the clothing, I only have one.
Oh wow. Yeah. I saw a couple others.
Those are the like inside.
Okay, I see what you're saying. Outside the house. Okay, yeah. Gotcha. Okay.
They're mostly for like wearing inside to the bed and their clothing kind of things.
Hmm.
Yeah. I have some tops though. That is one dress, but I have a few tops. Yeah, you're right.
Because I
have like red one and then the black one. I have a few tops.
Oh, okay. Because I know I've seen. Yeah.
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 Yeah, that's the only thing that is supposed to change because.
Yeah, I was slightly confused by that. It's like, wait,
but
you could have a small...
But a lot of women actually gains like more weight during pregnancy, which is not their fault. Mm-hmm. I don't believe that like to be the thing because some women starts pregnancy like at a lower weight, mm-hmm. and your body just thinks that, hey, a baby is coming. We have to store fat. We are going to starve and we won't be able to feed the baby. So... your body makes you gain more and more weight, which is perfectly normal.
Mm-hmm.
And she might be doing everything she can not to gain, but like she still gains because like body responds.
Yeah.
And your body is going to make you crave more and more foods. And yeah, you won't be able to help it, obviously.
Mm-hmm.
And someone gains way more weight and then their actual size changes too.
Mm-hmm.
Then you need, of course, up the sizes a little bit in maternity clothing too. Just not a big deal, it goes away afterwards.
Yeah.
Because sometimes women who gains like less weight, like let's say you gained like 20 pounds, sometimes you don't lose that so fast afterwards. Like you just lose like 5 pounds after hospital or don't lose anything because of all the liquids, you know, water retention. And someone who gained 60 pounds may lose like 40 of it in the first week.
Yeah.
You never know how are you going to lose. So like there's no need to be stressed about it during pregnancy.
Exactly. That's true.
But not gaining a lot during pregnancy helps with the self-confidence during pregnancy.
That's true.
Because you are not going to feel like you have changed a lot and then you won't be stressed. Oh my God, how am I going to go back?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I was thinking about different body issues during pregnancy. But you only came up with one.
Yeah, and boobs change.
Is that a
mine didn't
issue?
Change much. It is an issue for some women. They don't like it that way because they are not used to having like big boobs and stuff. They have to change all their bras and the weight factor. They are not used to carrying all that weight.
Okay.
So like they have back problems, shoulder problems, you know, here.
So does it increase by that much to where it's significant?
For some women, it changes 3-4 cups.
Jeez. Wow.
I mean, my size changed like 1 cup or so and I was already used to it before. So
exactly, yes. Yeah.
It
so
wasn't
for
a big
you,
problem for
that's
me.
That's what I'm saying.
Some women are very self-conscious about like nipples getting bigger and areola getting bigger, but that didn't change so much for me, very little, so it was not an issue. Water retention is a big problem. someone has a lot of swelling on their legs mm-hmm. and hands, and that of course is going to be really hard. It's not just self-confidence, you're all puffy,
yeah,
but exactly. like it also physically hurts you a lot because you are trying to walk on those feet and then they are all swollen.
Oh.
Like you have been in water for a week. It's like yeah. it's gonna hurt and it's going to be really hard. You won't be able to find your balance. Then you don't even think about the self-confidence issues anymore because you are so uncomfortable.
You just think about the pain.
Yeah. How would you support me if something like that happened?
I mean, I would definitely... You never told me that happened to you.
No, no.
Okay, but if you did, literally the first thing I would do is try to find potential remedies.
Yeah.
And you know, massage.
That could be, I guess, what? Massage, resting.
Exactly.
Raising my feet, not yeah. standing too much. But like, at some point, I think nothing really helps so much.
Mm-hmm.
If it's gonna happen, it's gonna happen.
But yeah, just... Yeah. All you can do is just try your best, you know, try your best.
I guess some doctors give like water pills to get rid of the retention.
Ah.
Mm-hmm.
Huh.
Yeah, there are a lot of things that can go wrong during pregnancy or that can affect you really badly.
Yeah, I was going to say not go wrong because that's normal.
Your yes.
Body retainings.
Yeah.
Your breasts.
Bad kind of side effects. And I was lucky that like I didn't have those
mm-hmm.
so much. I have the usual, you know, insomnia. I can't sleep in the night at all. I sleep like 3 a.m. or so.
That was pre-pregnancy, by the way.
No, pre-pregnancy I was good. I just didn't want to sleep. If I tried, I would sleep.
That's what I'm saying.
Now,
pre-pregnancy, you go to bed
yeah.
3-4 in the morning.
Yeah, now I can't sleep even if I go, so that's hard.
Because
of
the
of
pain.
The days. Not pain, it's just I feel so alert.
Oh, okay.
It's, yeah, it's pregnancy insomnia. It's like, I feel tired, but then like, just can't go to
gotcha.
Sleep.
Gotcha. Oh.
It's like that. I have back pain and all kinds of pain,
mm-hmm.
which is, it's okay.
Poor baby.
Baby kicks the wrong places sometimes and she does it like a lot sometimes and then that hurts, you know, lightning crutch and all that.
Yeah.
What else do I have? I have heartburn, which feels like you are about to, you know, burn.
Yeah.
I have nausea again sometimes, some nights.
Oh.
Yeah, when I can't sleep, I also get nausea at the same time.
Mm-hmm.
When I get up, my whole pelvic area is like about to drop and I'm like, let's try not to drop this baby. Everything pressures so much when as soon as I get up, it's like also hurts. It's like, okay, let's try not to drop this baby because I feel like she's just about to come.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, that goes away in a moment though.
Oh, okay.
It doesn't just stay that way the whole time that I'm up.
Yeah.
Yeah, I have those things, but they're not big things for me. I don't know.
They're manageable is what you're saying.
Yeah, they're manageable. I mean, I have heartburn, okay.
And what do you do for the heartburn?
Yeah, some people take Tums and stuff. Those things.
What do you do?
I don't do anything.
Oh, it just goes away?
I eat almonds sometimes.
Nice.
That helps, eating almonds or having some almond milk. I have some cereal.
Oh, okay.
With almond milk. So that helps because I don't like having milk alone.
Mm.
Any kind of milk. Also with back pain also I usually just kind of dance around.
Amazing, you have back pain, you dance around.
No, like do some movements, stretching.
You do the back, like you
go on all fours.
All fours, yeah.
Yeah, and go on to the ball.
Yeah.
A yoga ball, I really suggest a yoga ball for everyone.
Yeah, like
it helps. Yoga
ball.
I kind of like turn my hips around.
Yes.
I do some things
yeah.
to help. Yeah. In the last week, I also started having some contractions in the night.
Yeah.
One of these days, it's going to be like actual contractions.
Yeah, not Braxton Hicks.
Yeah, but they're not so bad right now. They are like very light. Like I can barely feel them.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's it hasn't been so bad for me. Yeah. I mean, I'm having these things and I still feel like when the baby comes, I'm gonna be really happy to have the baby, but
you're gonna miss
this I'll part. Miss this part. This was like this 40 weeks, it was the best experience of my life ever.
Wow.
Yes.
Nice.
It was really amazing. Okay, let's talk about how do I or can I support you? Because dads need support too. We always forget about dads in these situations.
I wasn't even thinking about
it. I just learned that dads can also have postpartum depression and anxiety. You guys are affected by this too. Hmm.
I guess due to the fact that I'm so excited, I never had negative anxiety. Mm-hmm. It's
just
only positive. Yeah, just excitement. Like positive, like, yeah, I got to do this for her. I want to do this. Yeah. I have nothing negative.
But I think you are like me, kind of like a lot of things happening. You just realize it when you are thinking about it. Like these pains and stuff, I don't sit around all day and think that, oh, I have back pain. You know, I don't even think about it. I think what you have is like mostly you have some pressure on you.
Pressure in terms of?
Pressure as in like you are trying to provide, mm-hmm. you are trying to do like whatever I need. Like I need things to be fixed.
Yeah.
For example, our AC was not working.
Yeah.
Which was a torture for a pregnant woman for AC to not work during summer.
Yeah.
It was so hard. And you are trying to find a solution,
yeah.
which was so frustrating.
Before Amelia gets here, because we don't want her to be in her room
burning.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. But we did get that fixed.
Yeah, I think what I tried to do during this process was that I made sure that you know what I need because I can't do it myself,
mm-hmm.
but also try not to pressure you too much,
mm-hmm.
because you also don't have the time to fix everything at the same time. So I try to tell you things like one by one with some breaks in between. Oh, I also need this.
Thank you. But in terms of not anxiety, it's more like I'm already feeling overprotective of Amelia. So it's like there are days when I just think about, oh wow, one day she's gonna be dating. How am I gonna?
Oh no, you don't like this conversation.
Exactly.
He's gonna tell her she cannot date until 30, and then like she's gonna try to hide things from us, 30, which I don't like.
35 or something. 36. Yeah. But that's what I think about in terms of, okay, so I have to protect her in any way possible, and there are gonna be times where I'm overprotective and she's probably not gonna like it. So what do I do in those situations? I think about that more than. What am I going to do when she gets here? I think I already got that part covered.
You are good with the baby part.
I'm good with the baby part, yeah. It's just like when she gets to like a teenager stage.
Yeah, we have time for those things.
Yeah, that's what I think about.
It will be
not
slow.
No, it's not going to be slow. No.
It will be slow.
No. She's going to grow
Please
up so fast.
Please let it be slow.
Exactly. But yeah.
Yeah, I also what I tried to do was like not complain about everything that is going on with me. But you don't like it, so.
Yeah, I want her to tell me everything.
And
even
then
if I can't,
he says you're in pain and not telling me, which I don't want to do. But I also don't want to say like each time I have back pain, like I have back pain right now. I mean, but like, you know, I don't need to keep telling you that because I don't want you to like, because there is nothing you can do. You know,
but
there's just
there's
so
something
much you
can
do.
Try.
Yeah, I know, but like,
exactly.
If it's an ongoing thing, if I keep complaining, it's not gonna help.
I get your point. I understand.
Yeah, I don't want to be like a complainer. But of course, we also need to speak about what is going on,
absolutely.
Especially if it is something big.
Mm-hmm.
I tell you if there isn't ever like any. Big going on.
Gotcha. Yep.
You always know if I have lightning crotch because
yeah,
because said, that makes me scream.
Yeah. That is true. So I think the overall takeaways, just be supportive.
Just partners being in it together.
Yes, exactly.
And doing everything they can is actually enough, I think.
And as the male partner, take the initiative, even on things you don't think you'll be contributing to. Key example, breastfeeding. Even if you're not going to be breastfeeding directly,
just learn what it is and how it works. And
absolutely.
Don't expect her to cope with it herself.
Yeah. Or don't wait for her to explain it to you.
Yeah.
Because she's already going through a lot. So for her to take the time out of her, you know, busy schedule, busy everything going on, to explain to you this process is, I think it's unfair to not just her, but to you guys as a team. So, yeah. And at the end of the day, this child belongs to both of you.
And I think what also helped us was, like, we still kept going with our date night.
Yes,
and
exactly.
Everything.
Yeah, absolutely.
We spend a lot of time with each other.
Yeah.
Whatever time we can get from both of our works, because we are both still working full time.
Full time, yeah.
Whatever time we can use, like, we keep doing stuff. We didn't just, like, on the weekends, we don't just stay at home.
Yeah,
we go out, do things.
Go to the beach.
Of course, being careful because COVID is still out there.
Yeah, exactly.
Now that we are also vaccinated, we are more relaxed.
Yeah,
and
that's true.
Yeah, just staying away from other people, but still doing stuff.
Together, yeah.
Yes, that was really good. One last thing to touch is support from other people, like other family members,
checking in,
relatives, friends, co-workers, right? My friend Minerva, for example, hosted
a baby shower.
Baby shower for us. I was
Thank
not
you.
Expecting her to, like, offer. I was so happy that she offered because I didn't expect anyone to offer that.
Yeah.
It was so nice of her.
Absolutely.
I mean,
Thank
we
you.
Did a Zoom a baby shower, obviously. Yeah. We didn't do an
in-person
one. Mostly because, like, everyone we know is, like, everywhere around.
Literally
the
from
universe.
California to. Delaware,
yeah.
So Georgia, yeah. So that was good.
Yeah, the people are, like, everywhere, so we did the Zoom one.
Yeah.
It was so amazing.
It was fun.
And my coworkers actually got us a gift card from Amazon, and they joined our baby registry, contributed. It was, and your coworkers contributed to our registry. Your sister, which was so nice, and.
Yeah.
My family made some, like, handmade clothing and stuff, and
which
they
you
sent
could probably
that.
See on our channel. Yeah, they made some amazing clothing.
Yeah, they are so cute.
Yeah, they are.
Yeah, we got a lot of support that way, but we didn't have the people around us much because we don't have family close by living near us.
Mm-hmm.
So
and also
that,
I mean,
which is a very good thing sometimes because we didn't have any family drama.
Yeah,
right?
Exactly. Literally.
Without the drama, we just got some gifts.
That's true, yeah. Gifts with no drama.
Yeah.
And we didn't have, like, a bunch of people telling us, hey, this is what you guys should do as parents. This is what you should do. And this.
Yeah, very little unsolicited advice.
Yeah. Actually, it turned out pretty good.
Yeah.
Turned out pretty good. Pretty good.
Because, again, that is something that happens a lot around us, like, on
exactly.
the groups that we are in. I want to do another segment on these mom groups that I am in. Mom groups that I am in, like, who am I talking to, how do I get support from them, because that is another support that is very important. Other mom groups and parenting groups, you are, like, in some dad thing, right?
Yeah.
On, like,
pre-dad it or something.
Yeah.
Something like that. Yeah.
It's like, even having online support is so important because you have a lot of women or men giving advice who went through the same things, instead of just your mom having just a few experiences of herself with her body talking to you like she knows everything.
Yeah.
This is like you ask them a question and then, like, 40 women answers you, and then, like, you can see different perspectives.
Exactly. Yeah.
And that kind of advice actually feels better than the other one that one person gives you advice and expects you to follow it to the end because they know better.
Yeah.
Because in this one, like, lots of women answers you your question and you learn a lot, but you also don't have to follow it.
That's true.
They're not gonna stalk your account and see if you did what they said.
Yeah. Your mom might do that.
Yeah, moms might do that.
That's true.
Yeah, and then they're gonna be like, I told you, that's not gonna happen online.
And my sister being in the, she's a nurse, and so she gave some good advice on Amelia's sleeping habits.
Yeah.
So that was pretty good.
Yeah, we'll see. We'll see how it works.
Yeah.
But it made sense to me.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
Yeah, she was saying to let her have some of the naps in the crib before move her bassinet to crib so that she knows that place.
Yeah, so she gets used to it.
Yeah. Yeah, I agree. Yeah. We'll try.
Yeah.
We don't know how to, like, work around the sleeping thing or anything yet because baby is not here. I believe that she'll be a really good sleeper and a nice baby.
We're all optimistic never on cries. That. Exactly.
I was like that, so I expect my child to be too. I know how you were.
I don't remember.
You don't remember? That's weird.
Your mom told you how you were. You don't remember that. You don't remember how you were as a baby. We'll see, you know. Either way, we know Amelia is going to be amazing.
I'm sure you were not an easy baby.
Probably not. Yeah.
You were getting into everything.
So then it's a 50-50 chance.
Yeah. So I'm going with, like, first baby being really, really nice, second baby being, like, hyperactive.
And then then on and on. And on. Nice. See what I did there?
You see how many.
Yeah. All right. I think we can wrap up.
Yes.
No? All right. Thank you guys so much for tuning in.
Thank you.
Any final words?
Well, it's been a really nice episode because it's an appreciation episode too to
That's
my
true.
Dear husband.
To my dear wife. Bye, guys.
Bye.
Hey, guys. This amazing podcast and many more podcasts on the Rob Radio Network can be listened to via the amazing Rob Entertainment mobile app. While you're in the app, you'll also come across exclusive videos and photos, information in regards to Rob Entertainment events, prizes and giveaways, and so much more. You can download the 100% free Rob Entertainment mobile app via Google Play and also at Apple's App Store. Thanks.
This has been a Rob Radio Network production. Check out our website at rrn.robbent.com. Thank you for listening.